there's three common types of lifelines. I've always liked these bare stainless 1x19 wired lifelines that I've got on my boat and put on other boats over the years. It's 316 grade quarter inch wire, which is size more than big enough for good grip and extra long life because you don't really need that much strength. So my system for a small boat like this is an open body turnbuckle forward and then back here a swivel gate fitting and an over center pelican hook. So these are simple and strong and no chance of chafe or stretch. And they're easy to remove. They should last 20 years or more. They are expensive. These plastic coated lifelines are more commonly found. They're typically 3/16, 7x7, 304 wire that corrodes with the 5/16 OD vinyl coating outside. The only signs you see are sometimes the rust streaking out onto the vinyl that it's time to replace them. So these are cheaper than uncoated stainless, but they're more dangerous, can fail. These lifelines are old and unsafe. You can see the rust stains coming out of them there and some damage. The lifelines on this Cape Dory 26 are 6mm 12 strand single braid Dyneema that I put together myself. You could go down in size to 5mm, but that makes them less easy to grip and UV damage would degrade them sooner. They recommend to replace them within 5 to 8 years, but with this larger size we have more of a safety factor and probably could extend that a couple of years. Besides lighter weight, they cost about one-third that of wire. These cost about $260, including the two eye studs for the pelican hooks, because we used New England ropes, but we could have spent as low as $200 and used a discount rope supplier. Of course, costs would be higher if you decide to use the special thimbles and gate eyes, and those can be reused when you replace the rope. So over the long term, costs would come down. Pelican hooks come in quarter inch and 5/16. These still need the locking nuts installed. We have a locking Brummel splice that connects to the pelican hooks here. Here at the forward end of the gate, instead of using the bulky eyes, we just put in an overhand knot, and even though knots reduce the braking strength a lot, they are so oversized, overrated for the job, that doesn't matter here. We use nylon tubing for chafe protection where they go through the stanchions, but if yours are well rounded, you probably don't need that. Up forward is another soft eye spliced in and then lashed with 1/8 inch Dyneema directly to the pulpit. This is a simple, low-cost way of making them as opposed to using more splices and hardware. I'll show you next how we put them together. This is New England ropes, 1/4 inch or 6mm Dyneema, called HTS-75. There's cheaper and more expensive types available, and I'll put links to all the components and sources in the video description. This rope's rated at 9,700 pounds breaking strength. It'll never see over 1,000 pounds load, even with a 200 pound man falling on them with, say, a 5-to-1 shock load. And they're never tensioned beyond about 100 pounds, so I did not size them for breaking strength. First step is to determine the length of the rope to order. Measure from the pushbit eye to pulpit eye for both sides and uppers and lowers. Add 4 feet to each lifeline for splicing and total that. Also buy 9 feet of 1/8 inch Dyneema or 3 millimeter lashing rope for each lifeline, which is this here. You'll need 2 splicing fids of whatever type you want, either the hollow ones or the ones with the hook on the end, a very sharp knife, some tape, and a plastic placemat for cutting surface. Once you've got your coil of rope, you need to cut each piece measured from your pushbit to pulpit measurement plus 4 feet. And don't worry about precision, since you will have a few inches left over to trim during the final splice. Dyneema is tough stuff to cut, so I wrapped the rope twice with masking tape and then use a very sharp knife with a sawing motion on a plastic mat, and that makes a nice clean cut. If you try to cut it up in the air holding it, you'll have some trouble. We'll begin by making a locked Brummel splice to the eye of the pelican hook here. I'm going to mark the line at 19 inches and 22 inches from the end with a Sharpie. Then pull the line through the pelican until the two marks line up with each other. Now we're going to push this small fid through this mark in the standing part, not the tail end. Now first we need to loosen the weave a bit by squeezing it together like that, and it opens up kind of like an accordion. And when you put the fid through, you want to make sure you got 6 strands on each side so that it's even. Okay, then we need to open it up further. So we'll put the second fit in right alongside the first one. Then we need to open this up further. So we'll put the second fit in right alongside the first one and kind of work them against each other like that, so that the end is easy to pass through. Now I could have pulled it through with this hook and tape, but this is faster. Pull that back. So we're going to pull that through until this other mark from the other side is right in the center of it. Now we're going to pass the standing part, the long end of the line, through the tail, about 3/8 of an inch from the first tuck, making sure that that one is also centered. Open it up. Make sure it's not tangled. And coming through the opposite way that the first one went, pull it through all the way. There's another splice you can do to avoid pulling lots of rope through, but it takes even longer. So we'll stick with the simple method here. Okay, that's the locking part of the Brummel. Now all that remains is to tuck the tail into the standing part. To bury the tail, we're going to mark the standing part at 22 inches beyond where the second tuck was made. That's where the fid will come out to pull the tail through. Now, between that mark and the pelican hook, we want to loosen this up a little to make the fid easier to pass through. Now, at 3/8 of an inch beyond where the second tuck was, on the same side that the tail is coming out, you want to insert the small fid into the core. And since this is 12 strand, it has a hollow core. And once we've opened it up, to make it easier to slide the large fid in, put in the largest fid that you can easily fit, and run it down all the way to that mark we made. And being careful not to have the tip of the fid get tangled in any strands. Now, once you get down to the point where the fid is about to disappear, you'll need to hook the end of the tail onto the fid, depending on what type of fid you're using, and tape it up so that it doesn't hang up. Now we can continue pushing the fid through. And it'll start to pull the tail through at this end, as long as that tape doesn't hang it up too much. Okay, we're just about there at the mark. So, we'll pull that out. Now we can pull on the outer sleeve as the tail buries itself in. Now we want to pull this tail out of the jacket until there's at least 9 inches exposed so that we can mark it and then taper it. Based on the diameter of the rope, we need to mark it for tapering. And in this case, 6 millimeter, 1/4 inch, we're going to make 11 marks, starting at the end, every 3/4 of an inch. Down to 9 inches. Then we'll get the tape off the end. And loosen it up. So that we can pull these strands out for tapering. It'll help if you roll the line and mark the other side as well. Because we want to taper it on alternating sides. This is all just to avoid a hard point. If we didn't taper it, the line would suddenly change its diameter from half inch down to a quarter at this point and create a weak point. Of course, it isn't going to matter on lifelines. They're not that heavily loaded, but it's a neater look. All right. Now we'll go on one side at the first mark and grab a single strand. Pull it from the end. And cut it off. Then we'll go to the opposite side, to the next mark. Grab another strand. Pull it out. Cut, and then continue the same process all the way down to the end. Okay, now that we've got the end tapered, we'll pull on it here until the tail buries into the standing part. Just milk it down. And there it is. A nice gradual taper. Now that's it. It's finished. And it isn't going to slip. Some people have added stitching to it to make sure it doesn't slip, but it's not really needed. Okay, I'm going to make an overhand knot a few feet away from the pelican hook. Attach it at the push pit. And then where we're going to pass through the first stanchion, we'll work our knot down here. And we want the knot to be about 1 inch away from the stanchion when it's pulled hand tight. Also, the threads on the pelican hook are fully extended at this point. Okay, that's good there. And I'm going to pass the end through. Go through all the stanchions up to the pulpit. The holes on these stanchions are half inch, so I can take, after I mark it, I can take the lifeline out, take it down to splice, and then bring it up and pull the eye through the holes in the stanchions. But if the holes in yours are smaller than half inch, you'll have to do the splice up here, and that'll require a slightly different modified Brummel splice, and I'll put a link to a description of that. Okay, well, pull that tight through the attachment point, and we're going to mark it 6.5 inches back. That's the end of the eye. And pull that out, fold it at that point, and mark each side 2 inches back. I've taken the line off for splicing the eye. There's the original mark, and these are the two marks 2 inches down. So we'll begin by
putting the FID through the standing part at its mark. Checking that it's even amount on each side. There it is. Open that up a bit. Pass the tail through. Until that mark lines up inside with that mark. Then we're going to pass the FID through the tail right here, just 3/8 of an inch down from where the first pass through went. I've taken apart the pelican hook and stretched this hole a little bit bigger so that I can pass the remains of the pelican hook and the splice through there. Since we have a little leftover line on the end of this tail and it's much longer than we need it, I've marked 18 inches down from this second tuck down the tail there. And that's where we're going to cut it off. And then we will continue to bury it just like we did the first one. It's important to take a good load on it, a couple hundred pounds at least, after you've finished both ends, to take out some of the construction stretch and to make sure that these splices are done correctly and they're not slipping. I'll show you how to tie the modified Buntline hitch, also called the Estar hitch. I'm using some larger line just to demonstrate here. Take your line through the top, and then on the left side, pull the tail over underneath the standing part and over again to create that loop there. Then you take the end through that large loop and in there to create a second loop. Now that would be the buntline hitch, but we want to make it less prone to slip, so we're going to add another couple tucks here by taking the end of the line through the first loop again and then just bring the end inside these two little loops right along the standing part. And then cinch it up. And that's it. Now that's not gonna slip. Get this eye to pass through the stanchion, I tie a messenger line, squeeze it really tight, and it'll pull through. If the hole in the stanchion is too small, then you need to do the splice already installed. Okay, we've got our modified buntline hitch on the end of that eye. We take our 9 foot of 1/8 inch lashing, pass it around the pulpit instead of attaching to this narrow eye here. Be stronger. Bring it back through. Now I want to cinch this down, but this stuff is so narrow it's hard to get a grip on it. So we'll give it several wraps on a tool and then pull that very tight. Pinch it off here so you don't lose what you got, and continue the wraps. We're going to do 4 wraps here to make sure it's strong enough. Get another good pull on it. Now that we got 4 complete turns, finish it off with a series of half hitches. And then we'll tuck the tail down in.